Hello everyone, this is Dr. Sangeeta Chaudhary again. I'm a consultant physician and today I'm going to talk about or discuss about the vital signs which we need to record during the general physical examination of a patient. In my previous class, I have talked about the general physical examination in brief and about vital signs also I have talked in brief, but today I'm going to elaborate about the vital signs. How do you record it and from where or which site you record it? So there are four vital signs: blood pressure, pulse, then temperature and respiratory rate. Blood pressure recording. So what are the things we should do while recording a blood pressure? If possible, the patient should not eat or drink 30 minutes prior to the measurement of blood pressure. And if your patient is on antihypertensive drugs, then the blood pressure should be taken before the antihypertensive drug intake. Now, how should be the patient's position? The patient should be sitting, okay, with back supported. The patient should possibly sit in a chair with back supported and the feet flat on the ground. And BP cuff should be tied on the mid arm and the arm should be kept at the level of the heart. So you can keep patient's arm supported on a table nearby. Okay, and the palms should be faced upwards. Okay, and the patient should take rest for at least 5 minutes before recording the blood pressure. And while recording the blood pressure during the procedure, the patient should not have any conversation. The patient should not talk. Okay. And when we describe the blood pressure or when we present the blood pressure while presenting a case, we should say the measurement, like the blood pressure is 120 by 80 millimeter of mercury, and you should also mention the site from where the blood pressure is measured. Suppose the blood pressure was measured on the right brachial artery, so you should mention it, because the blood pressure is not same everywhere. It varies from extremities to extremities. Okay, and lastly, you need to mention the blood pressure was taken in which position, whether it was taken in a sitting up position or in a standing position or lying down position. Okay, so again I'm saying, while describing the blood pressure, you need to say, for example, like this: the blood pressure of this patient is 120 by 80 millimeter of mercury, which is measured in the right brachial artery in sitting position. So this will complete the description of blood pressure, how you are going to present the blood pressure of a patient while presenting a case. Now, next is pulse. Pulse is a vast topic. It is so important that from the pulse itself we can diagnose many cardiac diseases. At least we can have some idea about many cardiac diseases. So where we should record the pulse and what are the things we should be recording in the pulse? So commonly we record pulse in the radial artery. Okay, there are a few subheadings in the pulse, or the few things in the pulse which we should be recording. First is rate, then rhythm, then volume of the pulse, then character of the pulse, condition of the vessel wall, any radio-radial delay, any radiofemoral delay, and condition of all the peripheral pulses. Now, out of this several points, rate and rhythm is best judged in the radial artery. But if we talk about the character of the artery or the thickness or condition of the vessel wall, it is best felt in the carotid artery. So other than radial and carotid arteries, we are going to examine other peripheral arteries also. By other peripheral arteries, I mean in the upper extremities or upper limb, subclavian artery, brachial artery, radial artery we are going to examine, carotid artery we are going to examine. Okay. In the lower extremity, we need to examine the femoral artery or femoral pulse, popliteal pulse, then posterior tibial pulse, then pulse in the dorsalis pedis artery. So examination of all the peripheral arteries has to be done while we examine the pulse. Now, the normal pulse rate, we say it is in between 60 to 100 beats per minute. How do you examine the pulse? Okay. While examining the radial pulse, most commonly we use the radial artery for examination of pulse. While examining the radial pulse, you can use two finger method. You can keep the tip of your index and the middle finger over the radial artery like this. Okay. And you can record the rate, rhythm and other things about the pulse. Again, I'm saying the character of the pulse is best recorded in the or best felt in the carotid artery. Now, after recording the rate, we're going to record the rhythm of the pulse. The rhythm may be regular, it may be irregular. If it is regular, it is fine. You're going to say that the pulse rhythm is regular. But if it is irregular, irregular can be of two types. That is regularly irregular or irregularly irregular. By regularly irregular, I mean the irregularity in the rhythm comes at a definite interval. Okay. So in this case, the rhythm will be regularly irregular. Okay. But if the irregularity does not come at a regular interval, okay, it is completely unrelated, then it is the rhythm will be irregularly irregular. One example for regularly irregular rhythm will be pulses bigeminy or pulses trigeminy. In pulses bigeminy, you will feel two pulse followed by a pause, again two pulse followed by a pause, again two pulse followed by a pause, and so on. So the irregularity is coming at a regular interval. Now, if we talk about irregularly irregular pulse, where the rhythm is completely irregular, there is no regularity of anything, then the common examples can be atrial fibrillation or multifocal atrial ectopics. So these are the two common conditions which give rise to irregularly irregular pulse. Okay. Now, there is something known as pulse deficit. From the pulse deficit, we can diagnose whether this is a case of atrial fibrillation or it is a case of multifocal atrial ectopics. Now, what is pulse deficit? Pulse deficit is the difference between the heart rate and the pulse rate. To record pulse deficit, simultaneously the heart rate should be counted and the pulse should be checked, and you should count the number of missed beats. Okay. So once you count the number of missed beats, that will be the difference of the heart rate and the pulse rate, which is pulse deficit. If the pulse deficit is more than 10, okay, then it is most probably a case of atrial fibrillation. But if the pulse deficit is less than 10, it is most probably a case of multifocal atrial ectopic. So this is how, from the rhythm and from the pulse deficit, you can diagnose a case of atrial fibrillation or multifocal atrial ectopics. So after rate, rhythm, we're going to talk about the volume of the pulse. Okay, the pulse volume may be normal volume pulse, high volume pulse, or feeble pulse. Now, how do you know if the pulse is feeble or if the pulse is of high volume? Because it is very subjective. So to know this, first we need to know the pulse pressure. What is the pulse pressure? Pulse pressure is the difference between the systolic and diastolic blood pressure. So normal pulse pressure is in between 30 to 60 millimeter of mercury. Now, if the pulse pressure is in between 30 to 60 millimeter of mercury, then pulse volume is said to be normal or good volume pulse. But if the pulse pressure is below 30, it is said to be a feeble pulse, okay, low volume pulse. Or if the pulse pressure is more than 60, it is said to be a high volume pulse or bounding pulse. Okay. This is about the volume. How we are going to judge the volume, whether it is feeble or it is high volume or it is a good volume pulse. Now, the next thing is character. Normal character of the pulse is also known as catecrotic pulse. In the normal pulse wave or in the catecrotic pulse wave, there are two waves. Okay, the first one is a percussion wave followed by a tidal wave followed by a diatonic notch. But these wave forms are not felt in healthy people, and this is because of the vascular tone. So theoretically, we know that there are two waves. One is percussion wave, one is tidal wave, and there is one diatonic notch in the descending limb of the pulse wave. But again, I am saying this is only theoretical. This is not practically felt in patients because of the vascular tone. Now, there are many different characters of pulse, and just from the character itself, we can have some idea about certain cardiac illnesses. Okay. Just for example, there are few characters, named characters of the pulse, like first is anacrotic pulse. Normal pulse is catecrotic. Anacrotic pulse is also known as the pulsus parvus ad tardus. This means the anacrotic pulse has low volume. It is slow rising and low volume pulse. It is seen in cases of aortic stenosis. Okay. Now, next is diacrotic pulse. In the diacrotic pulse, there will be a upstroke in the descending limb of the pulse. Okay, someone can feel two peaks. One is in the systole, one is in the diastole. This is known as diacrotic pulse. It is seen in cases of hypovolemia. It may be seen in cases of enteric fever also. Now, next is pulsus bisphariens. Pulsus bisphariens is a special character where there are two peaks of the pulse and both are felt in the systole. Okay, two peaks both felt in the systole. This is pulsus bisphariens. Okay, two peaks, one in systole, one in diastole. That is diacrotic pulse. So pulsus bisphariens is seen in conditions like aortic incompetence, isolated aortic incompetence. It can also be seen in a patient who has both aortic incompetence as well as aortic stenosis. Okay, it can be seen in hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. Okay, now one more character of the pulse is Waterhammer pulse. Okay, now in Waterhammer pulse, the pulse will have a rapid upstroke, a high volume pulse followed by a rapid downstroke. Okay, how you examine Waterhammer pulse? Okay, first you need to examine the pulse in normal position. Okay, you need to fill the radial pulse with the wave of your fingers. Okay, okay, suppose this is the radial pulse, so with the waves of the fingers you are going to fill it like this. Okay, with the waves of the finger, feel the radial pulse. Okay, and rest of the palmar surface should rest on the ulnar artery like this. So you are going to see the pulse like this in the normal position. Okay, and then suddenly you are going to raise the arm above the head. Okay, above the level of the heart. Okay, so when you raise the hand above the level of the heart, you can feel a rapid upstroke of the pulse here, a bounding pulse. It will be ill-sustained. It will have a rapid upstroke. It will be ill-sustained. Then it will go down. It will run off. Okay, this is seen particularly in cases of aortic, severe aortic incompetence. It can be seen in mitral incompetence also. It can also be seen in certain hyperdynamic circulatory conditions. Okay. And one more special character of the pulse we can discuss is pulsus paradoxus. Okay, the name is a misnomer. In pulsus paradoxus, there will be inspiratory fall in blood pressure by more than 10 millimeter of mercury. Normally also there is inspiratory fall in blood pressure, but that is less than 10 millimeter of mercury. But in pulsus paradoxus, there will be more than 10 millimeter of mercury inspiratory fall in blood pressure. We can see pulsus paradoxus in certain conditions like cardiac tamponade, constrictive pericarditis, okay, severe COPD. Okay, in these cases we can see pulsus paradoxus. So this is about certain special or abnormal characters of the pulse, by examining which we can diagnose, or we can at least have some idea about certain specific clinical conditions, specific cardiac conditions. Okay. The next thing is condition of the vessel wall. Condition of the vessel wall, though it is not given much importance, but still we can check for the any thickness, okay, in the vessel wall. Okay, if it is thick, it will feel like a cord-like structure, okay, which is somewhat suggestive of atherosclerosis. Fine. The next is radioradial delay. Radioradial delay, how do you check? You check both the radial pulse simultaneously and see if they are coming at the same time or if there is any delay in any other, in any of the radial artery. That is radioradial delay. Next is radiofemoral delay. How do you check for radiofemoral delay? You palpate the radial pulse and femoral pulse at the same time simultaneously and you see if the pulses are coming at the same time or there is a gap or delay in coming of the pulses. That is radiofemoral delay. And lastly, you are going to check all the peripheral pulses. If there is any abnormality in the peripheral pulses, that means whether they are synchronous, they are coming at the same time, or there is some absence of the pulse, okay, these things you can check. And for this, again, I am telling which arteries you are going to check. You are going to check the subclavian artery, the brachial artery, the radial artery in the upper limb. In the lower limb, you are going to check the femoral artery, popliteal artery, posterior tibial artery and dorsal asperis artery. So this is about pulse. Okay, this is all about pulse. If you are asked about what is pulse, what do you mean by pulse? So we can define pulse like that. We can say that, okay, pulse is a lateral pressure on the arterial wall, or it is an abrupt expansion of the arterial wall due to the pressure created by the column of blood which is ejected from the ventricle during systole. Okay, so this is the literal meaning or the definition of pulse. Now, next is next vital sign is temperature. So you can record the axillary temperature and you can note it down with the help of a thermometer. And the last vital sign is respiratory rate. You need to count the number of breaths the patient is taking per minute. Okay, with the help of a watch, you can count it for 1 minute. Okay, then record the number of breaths per minute. Mention if there is any irregularities in the breath or if it is regular. If there is any shallow breathing, any abnormal breathing, any deep breathing, okay, these things you need to mention. Plus, you need to mention the character of the breathing. It can be of two types, abdominothoracic type or thoracoabdominal type. Mostly in females, we see thoracoabdominal type of respiration. And in case of male, we see abdominothoracic type of respiration. Though definitely there are certain exceptions also. Okay, so these are all about the peripheral signs.